My name is Daniel Chow. I'm here today interviewing Helen Weng for the Houston Asian American Archive, and the date is May 10th, 2023.
My name is Helen Weng. It is my great honor to be interviewed by Rice University's Houston Asian American Archive. Here are some of my early photos of me in 1959. I was 11 years old. This photo was taken at the Taichung Central Park. This photo was taken on my 20 years old birthday. This photo was taken in 1969 at the famous Queen's Head Rock Formation in Yellow, Texas, Taiwan. Yellow, Taiwan. This photo was taken during my junior year at the National Taiwan University. This was my college graduation. After I got a bachelor's degree in chemistry, I came to United States in 1970. The last photo was from Christmas 1972 in Michigan.
So to start from the very beginning, could you tell us where and when you were born?
I was born in Taipei, Taiwan, on May 31st, 1948.
And how would you describe the household that you grew up in?
I grew up in a very loving Buddhist household.
Do you have any siblings? And if so, are you still close with them?
I have a sister. And we were still very close. We both got our PhDs in chemistry.
How would you describe the neighborhood and school district you grew up in?
I grew up in Hsinchu City. I attended the best elementary school in Hsinchu. I could walk to school. Here are some of my photos of my parents. In 1958, when I was 10 years old, here was me. In 1978, when my parents visited Houston, in 1997, my father's 80th birthday. In 2000, when my sister and I visited Taiwan on my parents' 53rd wedding anniversary, I only have one sibling, my sister. Here's my sister. in 2001, when family photo in Hsinchu, Taiwan. In 2007, on my father's 90th birthday and the parents' 60th wedding anniversary.
These are some beautiful photos of your parents. And I'm wondering, where were your parents born?
My father was born in China. My mother was born in Indonesia. They met each other in Taiwan at work.
And what were their occupations?
My father's occupation is a banker.
Do your parents still live in Taiwan, or have they since immigrated to the US?
My parents visit us and live in United States for over 20 years. They moved back to Taiwan in their 80s and both passed away in 2011 at their 90s.
So what were some important values or lessons that your parents instilled in you?
In male-dominated society, girls often receive unequal treatment. But in our Wen's family, with two generations of girls, that unequal treatment does not exist. As long as we are eager to learn and make progress, then whatever we want to learn, whatever we want to do, we will be supported. My parents integrated three values. First, wisdom. My parents continue to live and learn through their golden years. Two, kindness. They encourage good deeds and lead by example. Courage. They encourage everything and embrace innovation.
All right, so moving on, I'd like to ask, when did you learn English and what were some of the challenges in obtaining English as a second language?
I learned English in middle school. The biggest challenge is pronunciation. I had a foreign tutor who taught me pronunciation during summer.
Could you describe some of these graduation and career photos for us?
Yes. In 1973, my master's degree graduation in chemistry at the Vanderbilt University. In 1982, my PhD graduation in chemistry at the University of Houston. In 1991, at the Pennzoil Research Laboratory. In 1995, a poster presentation at a symposium. In 2001, in my office. In 2001, I had a 2-week business trip to mainland China with the company CEO and the VP. After the business meeting, we went to Xi'an City to visit Terracotta Army. At the Xi'an City gate, the photographer suggested that we dress in a period costume. I was dressed as the Empress being guarded on either side by the CEO and the VP. I will never forget this photo.
So where did you attend undergrad and what subject did you focus in, as well as how did you choose that subject?
I graduated from National Taiwan University, where I focus in chemistry. I have liked chemistry since high school, where I won the high honors in chemistry contest.
Did you participate in any extracurriculars, jobs, or other activities during college?
In college, I joined photography and the mountain climbing clubs, which I enjoyed. I also worked as a tutor for high school students.
During this time, did you have any professors or mentors in general who left a lasting impact on your life?
In my senior years, Professor Lin advised me on my research and the thesis. This was my foundation for doing research, and we became very close.
Wow, that's fantastic. I know, like, after that, you went on to pursue a PhD. And I was wondering, what career goal did you have in mind when you decided to pursue a PhD?
I wanted an advanced understanding of chemistry so that I could get a better job in the field of chemistry.
Right. And then after that, after you went to Taiwan University, what prompted you to move from Taiwan to the US and specifically Nashville in 1970?
I got a scholarship from Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee, in 1970. So I moved to the US.
Could you describe your experience moving from China to the US as a young adult?
It had to overcome the language barrier and learn to live independently.
So I guess there was a language barrier that you had to overcome when you moved to the US.
Yes.
Did you feel homesick?
Yes, I miss my family.
During that time, were you able to find a solid Chinese or Chinese American community at Vanderbilt or in Nashville in general?
No.
I'm sorry that that wasn't easy to find. But in the meantime, if you could offer advice to other young adults or anyone who plans to start a life in another country, what would you say to them?
I would advise them with the proverb, hope for the best and prepare for the worst. Prepare efficiently in foreign language. Independent living, such as cooking and driving, and academic learning, etc.
So looking back at this experience and having experienced education both in China and the US, how would you compare your experiences between the two? Did you find the teaching philosophies to be different between the two countries, and specifically how science was taught?
I feel like in Taiwan, it's more memorized. In this country, is more creativity.
Although you are now retired, you had a very successful career in microbiology and scientific research. Let's start at your first job in the US as a research assistant at Vanderbilt. What were your roles and responsibilities, and would you say you enjoyed that job?
I enjoy my job very much. That time, I was a teaching assistant. I just follow the postdoctor assignment to do my job.
And then how did that change after the PhD?
After a PhD, I'm a principal investigator. I assign job for technician.
Did you work with other Asian American researchers in your lab?
No.
So how would you describe the lab dynamic? What was the balance of number of graduate students to older postdocs and research associates? Do you feel close with your lab mates?
Each lab was run by a professor. Each professor had several graduate students and hired several postdocs. Each postdoctor had one or two research assistants working for him. Yes, I feel close with my lab mate.
So what challenges do you feel you faced in your career as a minority woman in STEM?
I would use two proverbs for encouraging them. One, as usual, so shall you reap. Two, well, there is a way, there is a way.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, both of those. And I see in your slides 10 through 12, you have some additional photos of your family. Could you describe some of these for me?
I have a four daughter, Emily and Karen. In 1989, they were teenage girls. In 1994, they were college students. Emily attended Harvard University. Karen attended Stanford University. This one was taken in 1993. This photo was taken in country Christmas 1995. In 1994, they were with Grandma Wang. In 1994, with my parents. There are some graduation photo of my daughter in 2003. Emily graduated from Duke Medical School. In 2004, at the carriage graduation from Baylor College of Medicine. The man in the photo was Dr. Michael D. Bakey, a famous heart surgeon. In 1997, at the English graduation from Harvard University. In 1998, at the Karen's graduation from Stanford University. In 1994, Karen's graduation from St. John High School, Houston, Texas. Karen's graduating from St. John's School with her grandparent and the uncle. This page includes my family most memorable event. In 1984, at my PhD graduation in chemistry at the University of Houston, my daughter Emily was 7 years old. Karen at the 6 years old. In 1991, the Dalai Lama visited Jai Buddha Temple. Emily, Karen were here. in 1994, when a family reunion at the Grand Canyon, my two daughters were very brave. They walked down by themselves from the edge of the Grand Canyon to Colorado River, 5,000 feet below, staying at the Denton Range overnight and climb up the next day. In 2015, when family reunion at the Yale University, we were standing in front of the statue of Mr. T.D. Worsley, a former president of Yale University, rubbing his toe is supposed to bring luck to accept by Yale University. This photo was taken at the Yale University Library. In 2019, we had a family reunion at my house in Houston. We were so lucky to have a family reunion right before the pandemic.
So what advice would you give someone just starting graduate school or just entering the research field?
I have to completely suggest you have to completely dedicate for study and work. You will be required to have a much deeper understanding of the material and will have many more responsibilities. They are far more responsibility in graduate school than in undergrad.
So in the future, what do you hope to see more of in the scientific research community?
In the future, I hope to see more women and minority in the scientific research community.
So I see you describe this in 13. What values have you found particularly important to instill in your children?
Social service, compassion, and justice as the guide for their education. Their roots lay the foundation for their professional work today.
And as described in slide 14, what is your children's relationship to their heritage and culture?
My children have a very strong bonding with their heritage and culture. As children, they learn about Chinese heritage and the culture from the Institute of Chinese Culture for over 10 years.
Speaking of Chinese heritage, culture, and language, what is the Chinese community like in Houston?
The Chinese community in Houston came from Taiwan, China, Hong Kong, and the other parts of Asia. In general, they emphasize the importance of family, value, heritage, cultural tradition, and education.
So looking at some of the change that's occurred in Houston, how has Houston evolved since you moved here in 1973?
Traffic got worse. Crime increased. Inflation increased. More houses and buildings, more population, more Asian Americans.
Now, this is something that's a little bit more of an issue lately. In the recent wake of the pandemic, there has been a rise in anti-Asian hate crimes. If you wouldn't mind sharing, do you have any thoughts on this recent phenomenon?
It is important to raise awareness about the harmful effects of hate crimes, bring criminals to justice, and promote a culture of understanding.
Do you have any hopes for the future of Asian or Asian American communities in general in the United States?
I hope Asian American participate in political election, which an important step for integrating into main study society.
So outside of your career aspirations, what are your current hobbies and interests?
My hobby are travel and photography.
So how would you describe your travel experiences so far?
Before the pandemic, in 27 years, from 1993 to 2019, we were fortunate to have traveled 43 countries. 42 states in the United States and 17 provinces in China. I have been the blue area on the next map, but not in the gray area. I was shown the map. Blue area I went to. Here are some photos I have taken while I traveled. This was taken at the Kawagabo Peak at the Lady Mountain, UNESCO in China in 2005. It is also known as Sunshine Golden Mountain. This one was taken at the Tibetan village in Yading, UNESCO BR China in 2005. The riverside village is surrounded by a vast meadows and a magnificent snow-capped mountain. This photo was taken at the Yellow Mountain, UNESCO, China, in 2006. It has been famous for both ancient and modern times, and its beauty and majesty have been described in well-known works. This aerial photograph was taken over Mount Fuji, UNESCO, Japan in 2006. This photo was taken at the Downfall UNESCO at the largest fjord in New Zealand in 2014. This one was taken at the Penguin Colony in Argentina in 2015.
Wow, those views are really incredible.
Thank you. In next six slides, well, all travels in six continent, Asia, Africa, Europe, North America, South America, and Australia. In Asia, in 2018, we visit Great Wall of China, UNESCO. In Africa, in 2012, we visit Great Peaks of Jinja, UNESCO. In Europe, in 1993, we visit Eiffel Tower in French. UNESCO, it was built to celebrate the 100th year's anniversary of the French Revolution. In 2017, we built Catch Castle, Rhine River, UNESCO in Germany. In Australia, in 2001, we visit Evergreen. In Australia, 2001, we visit Sydney Opera House, UNESCO. In North America, in 2001, we visit Evergreen National Park, UNESCO. We had a telephoto lenses and took per photo.
So as somebody that does photography myself, these photos were fantastic to look at. I wanted to ask also, how often do you travel to Taiwan, and are you planning any upcoming trips?
We visit Taiwan every 1 year or once or twice per year when my parents is living. But now with the pandemic, we plan to visit after pandemic.
That sounds like an exciting plan, and I'm excited for you to go visit again. In terms of how you identify yourself, would you consider yourself Chinese or Chinese American?
Chinese American.
As you describe in slide 33, how else do you feel like you identify yourself? For example, in terms of ethnicity, religion, core beliefs, or anything else? In other words, how would you describe yourself as a person?
I am a person, believe in love and compassion. Love and compassion are necessities, not a luxury. Without them, humanity cannot survive. This was the quote, Dalai Lama.
So if you could go back in time and give a piece of advice to your younger self, what would it be?
I believe the proverb, gratitude unlock the fullness of life. So I will be so grateful for everything I have encountered in my life.
As far as your family is concerned, do you also have any advice for your children or their future children?
Yes, keep working smarter and keep working harder.
Now, I see you have some description on your book and more details about your family and identity. Could you share those with us?
I publish my new book, Passion, the Legacy of Shui, with three generations of love, and hold a book launching event on December 16, 2022, at the headquarters of World Journal in Los Angeles. I took the photography on the front and the back covers of this book in earlier Tainan, Taiwan, 2019. The scenery of earlier is extremely beautiful, and the morning sunshine in the sky. This is my cover of my book.
Wow.
And this is, I took this photo in earlier Hainan, Taiwan.
I love how the photo looks.
This book talks about the six paths I have walked since I came to study in the United States 52 years ago. Path one, I finished my PhD in chemistry, found a job where I could apply my studies and stay until retirement. Let's see, I helped found and course the Texas Buddhist Association, the Buddha Light Temple, the J Buddha Temple, and the American Buddhist Center. Session four, Dr. Frank Chu and I launched the NTU 50th Reunions Foundation in 2019. Our 1970 graduate donated about NT$ 31 million and US dollar 493,000. It's fine. I have raised four daughters who are doctors and both teaching at the Yale University School of Medicine. Past sick, my husband and I traveled around the world from 1993 to 2019. We visit 43 countries on six continents. My daughter, Emily Weng, received the prestige MacArthur Genius Award on October 12, 2022. This is no strange attachment, USD 800,000 cash award. So Emily Weng can do anything for this money, like buying a new house. This fellowship is awarded to extraordinary talent and creative individual as an investment in their future potential. I am proud to be Asian American. From humble beginnings, I came to this country 52 years ago with a Vanderbilt University scholarship for graduate study. Step by step, I achieved the American dream.
This was truly an incredible message and very, very inspiring for future generations of Asian Americans. And I want to say thank you so much for sharing. And I'd also like to ask in closing, is there anything else you'd like to share or any final remarks that you'd like to say today?
I will emphasize, I am proud to be an Asian American. In 1970, I came to this country with a Vanderbilt University scholarship for graduate studies. I got my master's and a PhD in chemistry, then work in industry until retire and help grow the Institute of Chinese Culture and the Texas Buddhist Association. I have raised two daughters who are doctors and both teaching at the Yale University School of Medicine. I'm so proud that my daughter, Emily Weng, received Mark Arthur Genius Award on October 12, 2022. I published a new book in November 2022. Step by step, I achieved American dream. Thank you for this interview opportunity.
Of course, thank you so much for sharing your experiences, and I hope you have a good one.